Granola's backstory has been officially revealed, and it turns out he wants revenge. But who does he plan on taking his vengeance out on? We're gonna talk all about it right now. How's it going, everyone? Innovative JDog here, and welcome back to a brand new Dragon Ball Super manga review. In today's video, we're going to be taking a look at chapter 68, so if you haven't already read the chapter, make sure you go and read it first and then come back to this review, because I will be talking about spoilers. But before we begin, go ahead and smash that thumbs up button to help push this video into YouTube's algorithm, and while you're at it, click that subscribe button if you're interested in more Dragon Ball content like this. With all of that out of the way, let's get right into the review. If you remember from chapter 67, the Moro arc had finally come to a close, and afterwards, the chapter transitioned into the brand new Granola the Survivor arc. Serving as the direct continuation of the Moro arc story, we learned that 7-3 was actually still alive, and as a result, was taken back into custody by a group under the command of Master Goichi. We were introduced to the titular character of this arc, Granola, and watched him sneak onto the alien ship to steal 7-3's body away from them, with the chapter ending on his menacing grin. Chapter 68 opens up with a dream sequence where, right out of the gate, we learn about Granola's backstory and get some insight into his motivation for the remainder of this arc. It turns out that Granola isn't actually a Sufudian, or a Tuffle if you prefer that term, like we were all led to believe, but is instead the surviving member of the Cerulean race, who were all victims of a genocide brought about by the Saiyans. In this dream sequence, we see tons of Uzarus rampaging around the Cerulean planet, and we actually get a cool cameo from Bardock in his Uzaru form, since you can clearly see the scar on the side of the Great Ape's cheek, and that haunting image forces Granola to wake up. Upon waking from his nightmare, we learn that Granola keeps having similar dreams about the genocide of his people, and that it's been haunting him ever since Frieza's army was at its peak, prior to the destruction of planet Vegeta, which is a really long time. Granola's assistant Oatmeal asks if he still despises Frieza's army for what they had done, and Granola expresses his continuous hatred for the tyrant and his soldiers, despite Frieza being quote-unquote dead. Oatmeal encourages Granola to move on and no longer obsess over Frieza or the Saiyans, since they're all quote-unquote wiped out, so he no longer needs to seek vengeance. But even despite this, the dreams still continue to haunt Granola's sleep. Now, I'm not certain if these dreams will serve as some sort of motivation for Granola throughout the remainder of this arc, whether they be driving him to enact vengeance, or if he only does what he does just to make the dreams stop. But if they do end up being the prime motivation for his character, I would like that idea. Now, before we move on to the next portion of this chapter, I just want to quickly talk about Granola's assistant, Oatmeal. Throughout this chapter, we never actually see Oatmeal in person, and it's entirely possible that he's just communicating with Granola through those goggles that he's wearing. But I think it would be really cool if Oatmeal wasn't actually a person, but was instead some sort of AI within the goggles. Who knows though, maybe Oatmeal is another Cerulean who survived the Saiyan onslaught, but it would be a lot more unique if he was actually the goggles themselves. That way, he's always by Granola's side. Moving on, the chapter transitions over to Goku, who chases down and snatches the Oracle Fish, similar to what he did with Bubbles and Gregory on King Kai's planet. However, rather than this being a training method, we learn that the Oracle Fish is suffering from insomnia, which Whis reveals is a bad omen for the future. More on this later. My favorite part of this entire chapter, though, was the sequence on Beerus's planet, because after the Oracle Fish gets put to sleep, Goku begins training Whis in a one-on-one session. But this isn't your average training session, because without hesitation, Goku transforms into the silver-haired version of Ultra Instinct, indicating that he's gotten a lot better with handling the form. While he spars with Whis in a really awesome combat sequence, Vegeta and Beerus are forced to sit back and watch. Like I said, I loved this quick little combat sequence between Whis and Goku because it looks like Goku actually gave Whis more trouble than what we're used to seeing. Most of the time, when caught in the middle of combat, Whis can just lift a finger and he doesn't even need to break a sweat. But here we see him actually moving around a lot more than usual, and even then, Goku is still no match for him, which I love seeing. As their fight progresses, Whis mentions that Goku still has room to grow with his handling of Ultra Instinct, comparing the different levels in power between himself, Maris, and even the Grand Priest. This excites Goku, who is eager to continue getting stronger with this new angelic ability. Then we cut to the highlight of the chapter, something that was actually trending on Twitter when this chapter released. Vegeta questions if Whis is using Ultra Instinct against Goku, and Beerus retorts by saying that angels are constantly in the state, which answers why they all have silver hair. He then goes on to ask Vegeta if he plans on mastering Ultra Instinct alongside Goku, but Vegeta replies that he has no interest in even learning the technique to begin with, as it just doesn't suit his character. Beerus goes on to state that Ultra Instinct isn't the only technique of the gods, and implies that no gods of destruction have mastered it because their roles as beings of destruction doesn't make it easy to master a technique that focuses on tranquility. Vegeta goes on to request learning this technique, and Beerus declines the opportunity of training him. However, from that point forward, it's foreshadowed that Vegeta is going to obtain a new power that could potentially surpass even the powers of a god of destruction. Many people are theorizing that Vegeta is going to become a God of Destruction candidate and receive a new God of Destruction-like state, similar to what Topo had received. But I believe there's more to that. We already know that Vegeta has no intentions of becoming a God of Destruction because he doesn't want to leave his family behind, but I do think that level of power intrigues him, and it could help him keep up with Goku's training of Ultra Instinct. I have a video coming out very soon detailing what this new power could be, and whether or not it'll give Vegeta a new purple-haired transformation, like many people are believing will happen, so I recommend keeping your eyes peeled for that video if you want a more in-depth look at this topic. Moving on, we catch back up with Granola, who arrives at a mysterious-looking temple located on a gigantic asteroid. Upon arriving, he brings 7-3's stolen body to a rich and powerful intel group known as the Heaters, a family-run group that kinda reminds me of BoJack and his crew. All of the members of the Heaters group have names based off of fuel sources such as gas and oil, with their leader being named Alek. Successfully delivering 7-3 to the Heaters, Granola demands his money after a job well done and questions what their plans are with the body. Alek states that they have no desires for creating an army of 7-3 warriors, but instead plan on gaining power through the form of money and intel as opposed to sheer strength, and 7-3 just so happens to have plenty of intel stored up inside of him. Afterwards, Alek reveals to Granola that Frieza has been revived, which triggers the Cerulean into believing that he can finally enact his vengeance on the evil tyrant. Alek points out that Frieza is stronger than he ever was before, but this doesn't shift Granola's intentions, and he demands to learn the location of Frieza before he's taken down by gas in an act of disobedience. Alek tells Granola to hold off on attacking Frieza for the time being, which he agrees to, but after leaving, Granola vows to kill Frieza with his own hands, no matter who tells him otherwise. We then learn that Elek purposely mentioned Frieza's name just to anger Granola, as he knew that the Cerulean was getting way too strong, and if he ever surpassed any other member of the Heaters gang, it would certainly mean trouble. So by mentioning Frieza's name, he knew that Granola was going to get heated by the mere idea that Frieza had been revived, and as a result, Elek planned for Granola to seek out Frieza so that the tyrant could wipe him out before he became too big of a threat. This idea is really cunning, and I think it makes the Heaters group a bit more interesting. They're displayed as characters who think before they act. They're smart, and they know when to let other, stronger warriors take on tasks that could potentially come back and bite them in the ass. This whole dynamic of the Heaters being an antagonistic force to Frieza's army, and Granola just so happens to be caught in the middle of it all, I think this plot point has a whole lot of potential, especially if Granola doesn't actually turn out to be the bad guy. It would be insanely cool if after his scuffle with the Saiyans on Earth, Granola learns that he has to side with the people who once destroyed his own people in order to put a stop to Frieza's forces and the Heaters group once and for all. I don't think that's where this arc is going, but that would be a very interesting direction for this story to take. You know, sort of go for a whole, the enemy of my enemy is my friend type of ordeal. Also, I think it's pretty clever that the Heaters, a name associated with heat and fire, is serving as the opposing force to the Frieza army, who have names associated with colder objects like freezers and whatnot. It's just a nice little detail. Moving on, there's a quick segment where Granola gets ambushed by another bounty hunter named Soshiru. There's not really a whole lot to talk about with this section, but I will point out that Oatmeal's voice is used as a distraction, which adds further evidence to my idea that he's actually an AI within the goggles, as opposed to a person. We also learn that when his goggles are taken off, Granola has an oddly colored eye that helps increase his sniping accuracy. I know in the past, Toriyama made a one-shot manga named Kintoki, Toki of the Golden-Eyed Tribe, focusing on a similar idea where the main character had a golden-colored eye that helped increase his sniping accuracy. I believe wholeheartedly that this is a callback to that one shot, but as we all know from Toyotaro's recent character sheets for Granola, his eye isn't gold, but is instead a pure shade of red. It's a very noticeable difference, and I think it would have been much cooler if his eye was a solid gold. But aside from color differences, this is essentially the same exact concept. It's great that past Toriyama material is making its way into Dragon Ball, and I'd love to learn more about Granola's red eye within the next few chapters. Anyways, after scaring Soshiro off, Granola states that he isn't powerful enough to take down Frieza. However, to avenge the death of his people, he declares his goal of becoming stronger. With that, the chapter ends after the Oracle Fish talks in his sleep, stating that the strongest warrior in the universe will soon rise up, hinting that it might be Granola. But you never know, there's a lot of potential for the future of this Granola arc. Could the strongest warrior in the universe actually be Granola? Or could it be someone like Frieza, who will most likely play a huge role in this arc? Could Vegeta become the strongest after his training with Beerus and after the potential of unlocking a new form? Could it be Goku? Or could it even be Broly, who has the potential to be brought back into this story arc due to the heavy involvement of Saiyan history in this story? I think this chapter opens up a lot more questions than answers, and for the first few chapters of a brand new arc, I absolutely love the mystery surrounding what's gonna go down. I have no clue if Granola is gonna stumble upon Broly and decide to take him on. We have no clue if Granola will just be a red herring and won't actually be the main villain, instead deciding to forgive the Saiyans so that he can team up with them and take on Frieza. There's just so much potential for the story moving forward. Maybe even that is a possibility where he teams up with Goku and Vegeta and then betrays them. That would be interesting. Overall though, I loved this chapter and I think the future of Dragon Ball Super is going to be fantastic. As of now, the Granola arc is proving itself to be much more promising than the Moro arc, and that's definitely a tough goal to achieve because I personally enjoyed the Moro arc from start to finish. It definitely had a few bumps in the road from time to time, but that arc was pretty enjoyable when I look at it from a finished perspective, and so far, the Granola arc hasn't stumbled at all with its storytelling. Hopefully, I don't jinx that since this arc literally just began, but I'm hoping it has quality writing from start to finish. With all that being said, I'm excited for the next few chapters because I definitely want to learn more about Granola, his involvement with the Heaters Gang, and I really want to know more about his red eye. I also have plenty of videos coming out soon where I will go more in depth with Vegeta's potential God of Destruction training, how his rivalry with Goku will forever be changed because of it, and I also want to explore the significance of Ultra Instinct being an angelic technique. And who knows, there might be a few guest stars on this channel in the near future. So, if you're interested in all of those videos and more, and if you enjoyed today's review for Dragon Ball Super Manga Chapter 68, please do me a huge favor and smash that thumbs up button. The more likes that this video has, the more likely it will be that this video will be pushed into YouTube's algorithm so that more people like yourself can watch and enjoy this review. Also, while you're at it and if you haven't already, go ahead and subscribe to my channel because I do a bunch of Dragon Ball content. I make videos ranging from reviews, discussions, speculation videos, and I even do what-if videos from time to time. So, if all of that interests you, subscribe and turn on post notifications so that you can see whenever I post a new video. As always, thank you all so much for watching today's review, and also, let me know your thoughts on this chapter down in the comments. I want to hear your thoughts on the future of this arc. Do you think that we will actually see Broly come back because of the heavy involvements of Saiyans in this arc? How about Frieza? What will Granola do once he comes into contact with Goku, Vegeta, and the evil tyrant? Leave all your thoughts down below, and let's have a discussion. This chapter alone gave me plenty of ideas for videos before the next chapter drops, so remember, keep your eyes peeled for more DB-related discussions. Until my next video, I will be seeing all of you Dragon Ball fans later. See ya!